Welcome to Bethel Service this morning. We're glad you can join us as a respite from the trials and tribulations of today's world. While we look forward to meeting face-to-face, we're glad to have this opportunity to meet electronically.
He leadeth me, O blessed thought, O words with heavenly comfort fraught. Whate'er I do, where'er I be, still 'tis God's hand that leadeth me.
Hey, welcome to Bethel today. It's the fourth Sunday of Easter, and the theme is Jesus, the Good Shepherd. We are really happy to have Randy Shattuck with us today as well to deliver today's message. You know, I love seeing your pictures that we showed during the gathering song, and also the video greetings that you've sent. And we'll get to hear a few more today, but we're going to start off. I shared with you last week about Ken Leong, and they've sent us a little message from Reno, so check it out.
Hello, Bethel peeps. I'm Kit Leong.
I'm Ken Leong.
And we just wanted to give you an update on how Ken's progressing. After 32 days in the hospital and 15 days on a ventilator, he has survived COVID-19.
Kicked it. But.
And his sister's here helping with physical therapy. He's gaining strength. I'm feeding him three meals a day. And we know that this wouldn't have been possible without the grace of God, all the prayers that were said for Ken. And we just wanted to thank you. We've been doing puzzles and games and walking, and he's been doing exercises. So God bless you and peace be with you. Thank you.
It's a miracle. Without your support, I don't know if I could have made it. I appreciate your love and your prayers and your thoughts of me that helped me make it to this point. Thank you again.
Thanks, Ken and Kit, for your story of faith and resiliency. I'm really grateful that we have this community for support as well. So check out these things that we're doing at Bethel. I'm going to show you some schedules and talk a little bit about them. So for our adults, you can see that we've got a pretty packed schedule, including worship, some coffee hour Zooms, a hangout with Pastor Don, and some choir practices, so check those out. With all these things, you can go to the Bethel website as well to get more information. For youth, we've got junior high and senior high Sunday schools, as well as Common Ground Zoom on Monday night, and in a little bit, you'll get to see some of the products of our Common Ground time. For kids, we have our regular story times, check-in with the parents, and for this week, we also have a third through fifth grade Zoom game time at 1 o'clock, so you want to make sure you rush out and join that thing. Also, thank you for those who have given feedback about the Takeout Church 2020. They'll be ready to hand out early June, so stay tuned. Now, for all things related to kids, make sure you contact Amanda. So, you know what it is next week? Mother's Day. Now, that's an exciting day, always an exciting day for me with getting to spend time with my mom. This year, it's going to be a little bit different, but you can still do things to make it special. An idea that we're trying out this time is to have a Share a Flower Sunday. So here's some ideas how that can happen. You can put out flowers in a basket or a box on your porch so those who walk by can have one. You can draw flowers with chalk. You can draw a picture of flowers. Maybe take a picture of flowers or flower artwork. Be creative. You can even create flowers out of old toilet paper rolls, because I know you've been taking so many of it that you should have a ton of those. But once again, be creative. Then try to take pictures of your creation and send them along with your other pics that you send to communitymedia@BethelCupertino.org. because we want to share them as part of next week's worship service. So get those into us by this coming Thursday, the 7th of May, and we'll get them in and you'll get to see your creations. So as you can see, I'm not in the sanctuary right now. Without anybody here, it's been kind of lonely, and some of the things I'm going to do the next couple weeks are show you some of the different places so you remember what this place looks like. Also, since I'm in the youth room, I have a couple offerings to share with you from some of our youth alumni. First is Marcel Camargo, who was a Common Ground guitar player back in the 80s and now tours with Michael Bublé. Actually, I was going to go see them this coming Tuesday, but not for now. It'll happen sometime. And he did a really cool post on Instagram, and I talked to him about it, and he said it was okay if I share this, so I'm going to share this post about Marcel. I'm not complaining because I'm here with my family. We all have our health, a place to live, and food to eat. And no one here's drinking bleach. But I can't wrap my head around all that's going on in the world. All the people that are going through a much harder time than I am. All those that have died or lost someone dear. I also don't know what to do about work. Essentially, all my work for the year went away, and there's no way to know when it's coming back. And still, even with this disaster in my calendar, I'm not in a hole I can't get out of. In fact, the mega slowing down of the world is, in many ways, a welcome one. I'm not looking for anything, no answers or solutions, or help, or even a change. I'm just trying to say something that I can't exactly say with words. This is the closest I can get. Marcel, I think a lot of us feel the same way, and I appreciate you putting your thoughts into these words, and we will continue to keep you in our prayers as well. Also, live from New York City, two of our alumni, Laura Skuratoff and Krista Santos, have something they'd like to share with you.
Hi everyone, this is Krista and Laura. Welcome to Bethel's Sunday service. We are reporting from New York City. We are doing super well here, just hanging out in our apartment. What else are we doing?
We're making lots of music.
We're reading a lot of books.
Yeah, we're having a good time, and we hope you are too.
We miss you guys. Make sure to stay safe out there.
And pet your dogs for us.
Yeah, we miss animals. Bye.
Thanks, Marcel, Laura, and Krista for sharing where you're at and how you're doing. Now we're also in for another special treat, Common Ground. We've been so sad that we can't be with you guys in person, but we worked up a little something last Monday that I think you'll like, so check it out.
This is a song for the hurting. I hope that it helps you to heal. This is a song when the worst of the worst is all that you can feel. And this is a song for the lonely. If you've lost someone you can't live without. A song for the souls that are searching in hearts that are broken down. Sing with me now. Sing with me now. Hallelujah, love has won. Hallelujah, love has won. God is with us, thank you, Jesus. Though the battle rages on. Hallelujah, love has won. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Sometimes it feels like it's hopeless. It's a war just to hang by a thread. Sometimes on this side of heaven, oh, just doesn't make sense. And that's why he gave us this family, with a promise that nothing can break. That one day we'll all be together, and the devil can't take that away. Oh, so don't be afraid. He's already conquered the grave.
Thank you for that awesome musical selection, Common Ground. We can't wait to actually be with you in person again. Now, please join me in the prayer of the day. Let us pray. Loving Shepherd, we feel the wolves close at hand. Gather us to yourself, that we might dwell secure in your ways. Deliver us from evil, that we might build a community where all may dwell secure. Mark our fellowship with study, prayer, communion, and the sharing of our possessions with those in need. Amen. Now, we want to give you a chance to share the peace to those people near and far. I've kind of been thinking a lot about how that's working right now, and to me, this is a time where the near has become far, and the far has become near. So while we might not be able to be with those people that we normally would see on Sunday mornings, we have opportunities, and I've seen lots of opportunities of people who've reached out far across this continent, across the world. So figure out whatever way you can right now to share a piece of the people that that you love.
Good morning. Well, you are all in for a huge treat. I'm going to pass this over to Randy Shattuck, and he's going to introduce you to two of his friends, Violet and Pearl. I'll see you back here in a few minutes.
Boys and girls, I am lucky to have with me today two very good friends. These are my neighbors, Pearl and Violet, and they want to tell you a story about a butterfly. Well, and as you can tell, we are following social distancing rules because we're in both of our backyards and there's a fence between us, as you can see the fence here. All right, if you're Pearl, raise your hand and wave. If you're Violet, raise your hand and wave. Ah, now we know who's who. Tell me, where did the butterfly come from?
It came from this kit we got on Amazon. The butterflies weren't, they didn't start off as like full butterflies. We got them in a can and they were caterpillars and we watched them form into chrysalis.
I see. Okay, so tell me, what happened to the butterfly?
So the butterfly that we're here to talk about, Viola, well, she couldn't fly. She had a bent wing. All her other there were four butterflies, and all her three of the butterflies just flew off, and she was left behind because she couldn't really fly that well. So we took her in for like a day, and then we came out here again to test her flying, to see if she could fly, and she actually did fly, which is pretty great. Yeah.
And then she started flying up high, and then she went away with her other friends. And one time, we thought that one of them peed on Violet, but it had all its juice with the wing that's supposed to keep the butterfly going, and here it is right there.
That's the stuff that.
So yeah. Cool.
And
so
we feed them sugar water, and see that I'm gonna open this.
Okay, no.
So you feed them sugar water. Oh, that's cool.
Yeah, sugar water.
So,
and that's the spongy things that you can't take off, and you feed her sugar water, but I think there are ants on it.
And fruit.
So now I understand you also feed orange peel.
Yes, and
orange peel. All right.
And other.
So let me ask you a question. You named the butterfly what?
Viola.
And why? Now, viola is an instrument, a musical instrument, kind of like a violin. Why did you pick the name viola?
Well, we thought it was a really pretty name, and we just liked the name a lot.
Okay. All right. Well, is there anything else you want to tell me about viola?
Sure. So when we got her in the little can, all the other butterflies caterpillars were at the top forming their chrysalis, but actually she was the one that didn't make it to the top. She had to form her chrysalis at the bottom of the can. Yeah, we thought there was something wrong, but actually it wasn't, and there she is, and here she is. Well, we've seen her a few times. We think we saw her a few times, but I don't think it. I don't know if it was actually her or not.
Now, what color is she?
She's black, white, and orange.
Wow.
The type of butterfly is called the Painted Lady Butterfly.
The Painted Lady. That's very cool.
Yeah.
All right. Well, thank you, Violet.
All right. So we just met Violet and Pearl, and their story sounds a lot like the story that I want to share with you. The shepherd, the good shepherd, Jesus. Jesus is our good shepherd. And much like Violet and Pearl, how they took care of this butterfly when it was hurt, our good shepherd watches over us when we're hurt, when we're sad, when we're scared, even the times when we're happy and laughing, all of those times, our good shepherd is with us. So I really enjoyed watching their story and hearing about what they did. And I would like you to continue to think of their story, but also just remember this week as you go along, just that your good shepherd is with you at all times. All right, let's close in prayer. What does that look like? And what does that sound like? Good and gracious God, we know during this time when things are uncertain, and we might be scared, sad, lonely, that you are our shepherd. You are our good shepherd, and you are with us. When we're scared, you're behind us and in front of us. When we're sad, you are right next to us, sitting with us in that space. We know we are loved by you, and we hold on to that. In your name we pray. Amen. Okay, I'll see you next week. Take care. Bye-bye.
Thank you for that creative children's message. That was awesome. Now please join Doreen and Mark as we read the lessons.
Hello. The first lesson is a reading of Psalm 23 as written by King David. This is the New International Version translation. The Lord is my shepherd. I lack nothing. He makes me to lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside still water. He refreshes my soul. He guides me along the right paths for his name's sake. Even though I walk through the darkest valley, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup overflows. Surely your goodness and love will follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Here ends the first lesson.
The Holy Gospel according to St. John, the 10th chapter. Very truly I tell you, Pharisees, anyone who does not enter the sheep pen by the gate, but climbs in by some other way, is a thief and a robber. The one who enters by the gate is the shepherd of the sheep. The gatekeeper opens the gate for him, and the sheep listen to his voice. He calls his own sheep by name and leads them out. When he has brought them out, all his own, he goes on ahead of them, and his sheep follow him because they know his voice. But they will never follow a stranger. In fact, they will run away from him because they do not recognize a stranger's voice. Jesus used this figure of speech, but the Pharisees did not understand what he was telling them. Therefore, Jesus said again, "Very truly I tell you, I am the gate for the sheep. All who have come before me are thieves and robbers, but the sheep have not listened to me. I am the gate. Whoever enters through me will be saved. They will come in and go out and find pasture. The thief comes only to steal and kill and destroy. I have come that they may have life and have it to the full." The Gospel of our Lord.
Thanks for those lessons. Now, right from Studio B, Randy Shattuck with today's message.
Today, I'd like to tell you the story of Rosie the Riveter and her best friend Hazel that she never met, at least not to my knowledge. Well, you've probably heard of Rosie the Riveter. She's the mythical character created during World War II to inspire women across the U.S. to do work that they'd probably never done before. She's called Rosie the Riveter because so many women during World War II took up rivet guns. A rivet gun is essentially a pneumatic hammer that uses metal pins called rivets to attach things like large sheets of metal. A rivet is pummeled by the rivet gun, and this requires muscle, as the famous painting We Can Do It shows. The riveting technique was the primary way that airplanes and even some motorized vehicles were assembled during World War II. Thousands of women whose primary use of machinery had probably been a sewing machine before 1940 suddenly found themselves in factories with rivet guns in their hands. These women were heroes because they worked very long hours and because they stepped up to do work that was probably unfamiliar to them. Working in factories was something very few women did before World War II. But once it became clear that most able-bodied men would be needed for combat roles, well, that left a huge vacuum in the U.S. workforce. And Rosie the Riveter stepped in to fill that hole, and it changed the war effort permanently. There is an argument to be made that Allied forces won World War II because of superior caches of weapons, ammunition, and machinery. In fact, Admiral Yamamoto of the Imperial Japanese Navy, the same Yamamoto, by the way, who planned the attack on Pearl Harbor, well, he warned senior Japanese officials not to wake the sleeping giant, as he called it. As a Harvard grad, he had witnessed firsthand the U.S.'s production capabilities, and he knew that once the U.S. got the machine cranked up, there would be no stopping her. He was right. He had every reason to fear Rosie the Riveter, even though he probably didn't understand just how powerful she would be. More than 6 million women joined the workforce, and they didn't just rivet airplanes. They drilled, they welded, they cut with torches, they drove trucks, and they learned how to operate heavy machinery. Rosie the Riveter won the war right alongside the men who fought in combat. Rosie was powerful. I know this firsthand because Rosie hurt me. Rosemary Howard was born on May 28th of 1925, and she was strong until the day she died. I first met Rosemary when I was in my mid-20s. I was strong as an ox, and I pretty much didn't fear anyone or anything. But Rosemary made me second-guess my manhood. One of the first times I met her was at Circus in Reno, Nevada, in the early 1990s. I was in graduate school at the time, and my then fiance Kathy wanted to introduce me to her sweet little old grandma, or so I thought. I was expecting a demure little lady who liked baking cookies while wearing a red checkered apron. Instead, I met a woman who was nearly as tall as me and whose shoulders were certainly as broad as mine. But then it came, the hug that nearly broke my ribs. I remember thinking to myself, oh my goodness, this woman is strong. I hope she lets go of me soon. I grimaced through the hug and I tried to smile, but then she made it even worse. She grabbed my hand and squeezed, and I nearly dropped to the floor right there in the middle of Circus and started begging her for mercy. Suffice it to say, it was no surprise to me when I learned about a year later that she was an actual Rosie the Riveter. It all made sense to me. No more explanation required. As it turns out, she had worked on building airships in St. Louis during the war, and she was just a teenager at the time. But her memories of that period of her life were quite remarkable. Over the years, every once in a while, she would tell us a story of how hard the women worked, and yet how much they also loved doing it. It made all of them feel like they were contributing to the cause. One of the reasons that Rosemary grabbed me as hard as she did is because I was the first male to come into the Adams family in nearly 20 years. On the day that Kathy and I got married, Rosemary stood up and told the story of how the Adams family had lost two sons to sudden infant death syndrome. By the time Kathy was 13 years old, she had lost two brothers and her father. I suppose on some level, Rosemary saw me as restoration of at least some of what the family had lost, and I've done my best over the years to live up to that expectation. So that's Rosie the River, but I also promised to tell you the story of Hazel, Rosie's best friend that she never met. Hazel Pearl Guthrie was born on October 9th, 1898. She was my mother's mother, and she was an amazing woman. She was just as strong as Rosemary, but in a very different way. My grandmother Hazel was one of the sweetest and kindest human beings ever to walk this planet. She was strong in her faith and in her convictions, and she needed that faith and a strong moral compass to help raise the 11 children she and her husband brought into the world. And like Rosemary, she also lived through World War II and saw her loved ones sent off to war. Somewhere on her life journey, Hazel developed the habit of intense daily prayer. Now, my mother tells me stories of her mother starting her day by getting up before everyone in the household. She'd make coffee and breakfast, and when her husband and the children would leave the house, she would pray. My grandmother had problems with blood circulation in her legs, so she almost never kneeled on the hard floor. Instead, she would go in her room, close the door, kneel on her bed, and pray. She did this pretty much every day for about an hour. My mother also tells me that when her mother's door was closed, that was a sign that she should not be disturbed. Well, you can imagine how well that worked out with 11 kids. But Hazel was committed to daily prayer, to entering God's presence every day. And I'm told that when she left her room after an hour or so of praying, Hazel had a glow about her. One of my earliest memories from being in Hazel's home when I was a child was looking up at the famous painting of Jesus in the Garden of Gethsemane. The German artist Heinrich Hoffmann made this painting called Christ in Gethsemane in 1886, and I don't know when or how it entered my grandmother's home, but I remember gazing up at this painting. The light that surrounds Jesus seems very much like the light that surrounded my grandmother. Now, you might be wondering how these two very strong women could possibly be best friends when they never met, at least not to my knowledge. Well, the connection here links back directly to our reading today from Psalm 23. Both of these women loved the 23rd Psalm, and it shaped their lives and the decisions that they made. Psalm 23 has brought a lot of comfort to a lot of people for centuries. It's a lovely image, isn't it? That God is our shepherd, watching over us, even in hard times, even in our valleys. But there's one particular passage from Psalm 23 that I think really links these two women in a very powerful way. "You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies." Rosemary and Hazel both knew a thing or two about enemies, but you might be surprised at who their enemies actually were. It would seem for Rosemary that her greatest enemy would unquestionably have been the Nazis that she built airplanes to defeat. Could there be a worse enemy than Axis forces who threatened our very way of life? Actually, Rosemary's enemy was much closer to home, lying in the bed right next to her. I don't have all of the details, but over the last few years, some things have come to light. My wife was reading through some old letters from Rosemary's mother, my wife Kathy's great-grandmother. And in this letter, Rosemary's mother described Rosemary's husband as evil. And while I don't know exactly why she said this, I do know that Rosemary took action. One day, when her husband was away, she packed up all of her things and her children, and she left, and she never returned. She chose to protect herself and her children from a bad situation. Hazel also knew a thing or two about dealing with an enemy who's close to home. I recently asked my mother who she thought Hazel's enemy to be, and she said, "Well, do you really want to know?" And I said, "Yes." So she said, "Well, it would have to be her husband, my dad. He was not an easy man to get along with when he was younger, especially when he was drinking. While Hazel never left my grandfather, she struggled with him for years, particularly with his drinking. My grandmother was a card-carrying member of the CWTU, the Christian Women's Temperance Union, and this group helped to bring about prohibition in the 1930s in the U.S. And as we all know, this led to an underground network of criminal activity, like the rise of Alphonse Capone and others who trafficked in alcohol and prostitution and gambling. But the CWTU was also instrumental in bringing an end to child labor in this country and securing the right of women to vote. So you can imagine how it went in that household, a husband who liked to drink and a wife who was opposed to drinking, who was working, in fact, to outlaw alcohol altogether. That would have made for some very interesting dinner conversations. Oh, to be a fly on that wall. But this raises an interesting question for me. Who are our enemies today? I want you to stop and think about that for a moment. Who is your enemy? How do you know for certain that they are your enemy? It's an important question and one that I believe is central to the concept of God being our shepherd. In the gospel reading from John today, we hear Jesus describe himself as the good shepherd. The number one quality that makes him a shepherd is the sound of his voice. Jesus says, "My sheep know my voice, and they won't follow a stranger." Knowing the sound of his voice, following where he leads. This seems to be at the very heart of the relationship with the good shepherd. But I'm not very fond of this whole concept of being a sheep. I don't like that one so much. If you've spent any time around sheep, you know they're not all that bright. They tend to wander off and to get eaten by wolves, and without the shepherd, they're in trouble. Well, this doesn't line up so well with my preferred self-image, the rugged individualist. And yet, if I'm being honest with myself, I have a pretty poor record when it comes to identifying who my enemies are and what can really hurt me. This is one of the reasons I'm glad I have the example of Rosemary and Hazel. Both of these women faced some pretty tough situations in life that could have pulled them down a dark path, but they didn't let that happen. They chose a different path. So I ask you again, who are your enemies? Could it be that our enemies are those people and those situations in life that block our ability to hear Jesus' voice? Could it be that our enemies are those voices that prevent us from being bold enough to do the will of God? Could these really be our enemies? If that's the case, then those closest to us could certainly become our enemies if we prize them more than we prize our relationship with Jesus. If this is the case, our enemies might even be dead and buried, and yet their voice, their influence could still be pulling us in the wrong direction. I know I've certainly struggled with things that were said and done to me by people who are no longer living. Well, there's certainly scriptural precedence for this idea. First, there's the story of Mary and Martha. Martha complained to Jesus that her sister Mary wouldn't help with the chores. Apparently, Mary was being lazy, just sitting around at the feet of Jesus all day long and listening to him for hours on end. Jesus described this as the good part of life, and he said that he wouldn't take that away from Mary. Then there's the story of Peter, who in one breath is called the rock, and in the next breath, Jesus calls him Satan. Well, how can that be? How can Peter go from being the very picture of faith to being evil, all within a few verses? Jesus says that Peter is not focused on the will of God, but instead is focused on what Peter wants, a Messiah to defeat and throw out the Romans. Jesus knew that he was bound for the cross, and he would not deviate from that path, and he wouldn't even allow Peter to suggest it. Then there are the so-called hard sayings of Jesus, like this one from Luke. If you don't hate father, mother, sister, brother, husband, wife, child, or even your own life, you can't be my disciple. Well, this seems to be in direct contradiction to the Ten Commandments, which tell us to honor our mother and our father. How can it be that Jesus asks us to hate them? Of course, this is hyperbole. Jesus is not asking us to hate our loved ones. Jesus is reminding us, warning us really, about what can happen if we get our priorities out of whack. He's reminding us of the importance, the preeminence of the first commandment, to love God with all of our heart. These days, it might seem like our greatest enemy is the COVID-19 pandemic. I know I've certainly said a lot of prayers for people who are sick and who've passed away. These are indeed trying times. But I want to remind you of something about the presence of enemies. The great promise from Psalm 23 and John 10 is that we do not face enemies alone. We're told that we can have a feast even as we walk through the valley of the shadow of death. We're promised the presence of our Lord and the sound of his voice even as we face the most painful of situations. I want to remind you that you do not walk alone, that Jesus walks with you through your valleys, through your darkest moments. You have the blessing of Jesus' voice calling to you, comforting you, and reminding you of how important you are. Do not be afraid, my friends. You don't walk alone. Like Rosemary and Hazel, the Good Shepherd walks with you. Amen.
Whose goodness faileth not.
Uplifted by the promised hope of healing and resurrection, we join the people of God in all times and places in praying for the church, the world, and all who are in need. Creating God, we praise you for the spring season following our winter rains. Strengthen those who plant and harvest crops, and those involved in agriculture of any kind. Strengthen their hands as they feed the world. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Nurturing God, we thank you for medical professionals and first responders and essential workers. Guide them in the struggle against COVID-19. Bless them as they work for everyone's health. We pray for those suffering and recovering from COVID-19. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Comforting God, you carry us tenderly. We pray for those who walk through dark valleys, overshadowed by anxiety and overwhelmed with suffering. We pray for Betty Danielson, Betty Pohl, Sunnyview Retirement Community, and Dave Denny, Melanie Brulette, Doc Bartow, Rich Hahn, and Terry Covet. We ask your protection for all frontline and essential workers. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord, we raise our prayers to you for family, friends, and community. Into your hands, O Lord, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy and grace through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. And now we join in praying the words that Jesus taught us to pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
Thanks, Greg, for the prayers. Now, I hope you enjoy this next selection, a great song called Rest in Me by Clayton. During the song, you'll also see opportunities to give, so give as you can and enjoy this song. Thank you.
words flow to a vision, heaven and earth, a new creation. And you can join, you can join, you can join, you can join into.
You can join, you can join, you can join into.
Now receive the blessing. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May God's face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. May God give you the grace to never sell yourself short. Grace to risk something big for something good. Grace to remember that the world is too dangerous for anything but truth and too small for anything but love. So may God take your minds and think through them. May God take your lips and speak through them. May God take your hearts and set them on fire. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Go in peace and serve the Lord. Okay, we will.
I lost my vision when the pain set in. Can I believe what I don't see? Can I really let it be out of my hands when it's out of my hands? This isn't what I choose, but it's where I'm finding you. When I'm broken and undone, your mercy's just begun. You overcome my doubt, your hands are reaching out. You hold me through the storm.